Welcome, everybody. The title of this presentation is Sad by Design. I'm going to read a few fragments of the book and the writings that happened in the last 2 years. They're focused on the question of the mental state in which we find ourselves. Sadness, melancholy, anger, loneliness. And for me, these are very good starting points to discuss alternative strategies. We cannot just talk about politics. We need to share amongst us how we feel and how technology is impacting us. So that's what I'm going to read some of the fragments in the coming 20 minutes. Let's dive into social media weariness, the cause of our tired eyes. What are the techniques of resignation that we are exposed to? The blissful ignorance after browsing an entire ecosystem of narratives is not surprising. Culture is a pendulum, and the pendulum is swaying. The organized optimism, hard-coded in online advertisement and other forms of algorithmic advice, turned out to be merely producing anxiety. As Carolyn Coles Richard stated, what can't be cured must be endured. The suffering, sorrow, and misery is getting tagged and filtered by our own anger and self-censorship. We've been captured and feel frozen. What we receive is the anger and anxiety of the online other. The growing imbalance in the distribution of digital enchantment is neither causing a revolution or revolt, nor does it fade out. Welcome to the great stagnation. We, the online billions, are stuck on the platform. Once we're locked in, the path to infinity has been blocked. Instead, we're caught in a Truman Show-like repetition of the perpetual now, toiling around in the micro mess of online others that try to do their best, masking their failures and despair, like everyone else. Franco Berardi observes the mental state of today's student. I quote, "I see them from my window," he writes, "lonely, watching the screens of their smartphones, nervously rushing to classes, sadly going back to the expensive rooms that their families are renting for them. I feel their gloom. I feel the aggressiveness latent in their depression." In the social media era, the Oblomov position is no longer an option, in particular for those that cannot economically afford to get stuck within the abyss. We experience the sadness of online existentialism minus the absurdity. If only interpassivity was ever really implemented in code instead of being yet another Austrian idea, we would indulge in a permanent state of indolent apathy. Instead, there's nothing passive
about the human-machine interactives. Being unsocial, the Zen status of detachment, is an ontological impossibility. We're never really lurking. Our presence is always noted. And we can therefore never truly enjoy the secretive voyeur status. Interaction is our tragic existence. Instead, we're constantly asked to fill in forms, upgrade, and rank our taxi drivers. Even technological sadness is a style, albeit a cold one. The sorrow, no matter how short, is real. This is what happens when we can no longer distinguish between telephone and society. If we can't freely change our profile and feel too weak to delete the app, we're condemned to feverishly check for updates during the brief in-between moments of our busy lives. In a split second, the real-time machine has teleported us out of our current situation and onto another playing field filled with micro reports we quickly have to investigate. Omnipresent social media places a claim on our elapsed time, our fractured lives. We are all sad in our very own way. As there are no lulls or quiet moments anymore, the result is fatigue, depletion, and loss of energy. We're becoming obsessed with waiting. How long have you been forgotten by your loved ones? Time, meticulously measured on every app, tells us right to our face. Chronos hurts. Should I post something to attract attention and show that I'm still there? Nobody likes me anymore. As the random messages keep relentlessly piling in, there's no way to hold them. Take a moment and think it all through. Delacroix once declared that every day which is not noted is like a day that does not exist. Diary writing used to fulfill that task. Elements of early blog culture tried to update the diary form for the online realm, but that moment has now passed. Unlike the blog entries of the Web 2.0 era, social media have surpassed the summary state of the diary in a desperate attempt to keep up with the real-time regime. Instagram stories, for example, bring back the nostalgia of an unfolding chain of events and then disappear at the end of the day, like a revenge act, a satire of ancient sentiments gone by. Storage will only make the pain permanent. Better forget about it and move on. In the online context, sadness appears as a short moment of indecisiveness, a flash that opens up the possibility of a reflection. The frequently used sad label is a vehicle, a strange attractor to enter the liquid mass called social media. Sadness is a container. Each and every situation, especially the one we're in right now, can potentially be qualified as sad. Through this mild form of suffering, we enter the blues of being in the world. When something is sad, things around it become gray. You trust the machine because you feel you're in control of it. You want to go from zero to hero. But then your propped up ego implodes, and the failure of self-esteem becomes apparent again. The price of self-control in an age of instant gratification is high. We long to revolt against the restless zombie inside us, but we don't know how. Our psychic armor is thin and eroded from within, open to behavioral modifications. Sadness arises at the point where we're exhausted by the online world after yet another app session in which we failed to make a date, purchased a ticket, and did a quick round of videos. The post-dopamine mood hits us hard. The sheer busyness and self-importance of the world makes you feel joyless. After a dive in the social network, we're drained and feel socially awkward. The swiping finger is tired, and we have to stop. You should be careful to distinguish sadness from anomalies such as suicide, depression, and burnout. Everything and everyone can be called sad, but not everyone is depressed. Much like boredom, sadness is not a medical condition. Though never say never, because everything can be turned into one. No matter how brief and mild, sadness is the default mental state of the online billions. Its original intensity gets dissipated. It seeps out and becomes a general atmosphere, a chronic background condition. Occasionally, for a brief moment, we feel the loss. A seething rage emerges. After checking for the 10th time what somebody said on Instagram, the pain of the social makes us feel miserable and we put the phone away. Am I suffering from the phantom vibration syndrome? Wouldn't it be nice if we were offline together? Why is life so tragic? He blocked me at night. You read his messages again. Do we need to quit again? Go cold turkey again? Others are supposed to move us, to arouse us, and yet we don't feel anything anymore. The heart is frozen. Let's compare the fleeting sadness in its technical form with the ancient state of melancholia, the melancholic personality of the past, seemed to suffer from a disease. Unable to act, she withdraws from the world, contemplating death and other transient phenomena. While some read this condition as depression and boredom, others refrain this lazy passivity as a creative strategy, waiting for inspiration to strike. Instead of a fascinating derive into the vast arsenal of literary sources, I propose here a general hermeneutics that short-circuits the philology with the internal presence of the digital that surrounds us. Melancholy, often described as sadness without a cause, has strong existential connotations. While paying tribute to Kierkegaard, who liberated melancholia once and for all of its medical stigma, describing it as the deepest foundation of the human in a godless society, the problem here is not a vertical one of going deeper, but a horizontal one. The democratization of sadness happens through its thin spread across the plateau. Homeopathic doses flatly distributed via technical means. Melancholia is a thing of the past because there's simply no time anymore to indulge in a wistful state. One could, of course, defend that techno-sadness still bears the possibility of melancholy. The implosion of the factor time has all but sabotaged the possibility to seriously drift off. Real-time machines constantly draw us back online, capture our attention, and do not allow extensive mourning. Strangely, melancholy requires concentration and focus. Distraction, on the other hand, is all over the place. And thus, the sadness is microdosed. The metric to measure today's symptoms would be time, or attention, as it is called in the industry. While for the archaic melancholic, the past never passes, techno-sadness is caught in the perpetual now. Forward-focused, we bet on acceleration and never mourn a lost object. The primary identification here is in our hand. Everything is evident on the screen, right in your face. While confronted with the rich historical sources that dealt with melancholia, the contrast with our present condition becomes immediately apparent. Whereas melancholy in the past was defined by separation of others, reduced contacts, and reflection on oneself, today's tristesse plays itself out amidst busy social media interactions. In Sherry Turkle's phrase, we are alone together as part of the crowd, a form of loneliness that is particularly cruel, frantic, and tiring. How can we redesign the social in such a way that will become impossible, even unthinkable for trolls and bots that try to permanently distract our thinking and behavior to occur. We cannot spend all the time and energy to reinvent the social without taking freedom into account, not the liberty as defined by right-wing libertarians, but freedom as Hannah Arendt and Isaac Berlin speak about. This is not just freedom from addictive and manipulative software. Can we rethink bots and algorithms in such a way that that they become pets and toys, tools again, that work for us instead of invisible, oppressive systems that try to deceive and educate us? Technological freedom means the ability to them to put them aside and to turn them off. We long for tools that assist us instead of colonizing our inner life behind our backs. Our sadness will not be overcome with anger. We need to reinvent the techno-social in a radical manner, here, right now, in Barcelona, Amsterdam, in Europe. Thank you very much. By design.